expressions. Okay, then control flow. Let's assume, as in most mainstream programming languages, that we have sequential program flow, right? We, you know, what you know, basic programming we learn, basically all of them are sequential program flow. Okay, and then procedure execution begins at the first statement of the procedure body, right? Then when procedure returns, execution returns to the instruction immediately following the procedure call. So when it becomes non-sequential, if something happens after the 10th line, it goes to, you know, some, there is a if else or some level or so, some condition, so it jump to some, you know, 50th line of the code, then from 50th line of the code due to some, you know, process call, or say there is another label, you know, which is referred, say 30th line. So it is going to be, if the program is executing this manner, then it is going to be, you know, non-sequential, all right? So activations, you will see, every execution of a procedure is called activation, right? That means the process is active. A lifetime of an activation of procedure P is the sequence of steps between first and last step of P's body. Okay, that means so P is a process, right? So the first statement, and there is the nth statement is the last statement. So it is all about, you know, going through this sequence of statements. Okay, so including any procedure call while P is running. So that means if P is calling some procedure Q, so including that also. Okay, so normally when control flow from one activation to another, it must eventually return to the same activation. When activation are tersely nested, we can represent control flow with activation trees. Okay, so here one example of an activation record for QuickShot. You can see execution begins, then enter a read array. So what happens? The control enters into the read array process. So read array is a process, you know, right? Then lib read array process. So this process exists here. Then the data are being already recorded. So with the data, it enters to the QuickShot function. Okay. Then QuickShot function calls another function called partition, right? So QuickShot need to do the partition of the array. So it calls the partition function. Partition function does the partition and all. Then returns the partition to QuickShot and it terminates, right? Then again it enters to the QuickShot. Then QuickShot does the short of this partition. We all know, okay. Then it leaves the QuickShot, then again it enters the QuickShot, again it leaves the, why? Because for each of the partition it is happening, right? It is calling QuickShot itself recursively for each of the partition, understand? So finally, all the partition are, you know, shorted, the execution terminated, understand? So here you can see how the QuickShot works. This is the activation tree. This is called activation tree. So here you can see R is, you can say, the array, right? So you can see at the top it is, you know, when this function of the Q is representing QuickShot, you know, it have 1 to 9 all the element. Then it is partitioned like this, 1 to 4, and so partition function is doing this, you know, partition of the array, right? And 5 to 4, so 4 element here, so 1 2 3, so 3 element this side, right? 1 to 3 element, and 4th element is not here, you can see, and 5th 6th 7th 8th and 9th element are come to this side. Okay, then you can see this is again, you know, partitioned into one to zero and two to three, right? And this is again partitioned into, you know, P means partition here, okay? So partition is called, which is basically doing this partition. The second partition with these elements are called doing this partition, okay? Then it again comes back to quick short. Then again it does partition, then quick short, you know, this partition is finally going to be shorted by the quick short, because you can see, no, this is a 7 and 7 element. That means the one element is, one elements are there. So it is possible to, you know, short it there. So in this way, this quick short activation tree can be represented. So activation records. Procedure calls and return are usually maintained by runtime stack called control stack. Each live activation has an activation record. That we already know, right? The root of the activation tree is the bottom of the stack, okay? And the current execution path specifies content of the stack with the last activation has recorded in the top of the stack, okay? So a general activation record looks like this. It have I have already shown you previously. So it have a return value. The return value of the called procedure is returned in this field to the calling procedure, right? So in practice, we may use machine register for return value. Then actual parameter, the field for actual parameter used by the calling procedure to supply parameter to the called procedure, right? Then optional, this is optional control link. The optional control link points to the activation record of the caller, right? Because when the called function will be, you know, terminated, rend its execution, it need to go back to the, you know, caller function. So this link is saved here. Then optional access link. The optional access link is used to refer non-local data held in other activation record. Okay. Then saved machine status. The field saved machine status hold information about state of the machine before procedure is called. And then local data. The field of local data holds data that local to an execution of a procedure. You understand what is local data, right? That means local variables, basically. Examples are local variables. Then temporary. So temporary variables is are stored in the field of the temporaries. So we understood all these things. Then downward growing stack of activation record, because, you know, for the better representation, we show the stack upside down. So the our stacks increases in the downward direction, right? So you can see here first main function called. So in the stack, main entered, then main calls this read element function, right? So R is activated, then the I number of integers are going to be stored here, right? Then this work of this is done, right? So read function is terminated, okay? So you can see here, read function is no more there in this stack, okay? Main is there, read is popped out, and so integer M and N and stored as a local data, then it is calling quick short function with this element 1 to 9, right? And this integer I. Understand? Then you can see here, quick short 1 to 9 is not ended is its execution. It is basically calling another instance of the quick short with 1 to 3 element, right? So this is the way the activation record is maintained in the stack, okay? Then designing the calling sequences. Values communicated between caller and callee are generally placed in at the beginning of the callee's activation record. So fixed length items are generally placed in the middle, and item whose size may not be known early enough are placed at the end of the activation record. Okay, so we must locate the top of the stack pointer judiciously. A common approach is to have it point to the end of fixed length field. So here you can see division of task between the caller and callee. So all these details, I'm not going every detail. Okay, in calling sequence, the caller evaluates the actual parameters. The caller stores a return address when the old value of top of the stack into the callee's activation record. So the callee saves the register values and other status information. The callee initializes its local data and begins the execution. The calling sequence for procedure allocates an activation record and fills its fields in with appropriate values. So some of the callee sequence code is part of the calling procedure and some is part of the called procedure. So what goes where depends on the language and machine architecture. So it is exactly, you can't say that this is happens on all the machine. It is definitely depends on the architecture of the machine, what kind of machine is being used. Understand? Then corresponding return sequence. The callee places a return value next to the parameters using information in the machine status field. The callee restores the top of the stack and other register and then branches to the return address that the caller placed in the status field. So we know it already, right? So the caller always puts address where to return. Then although top of the stack has been decremented, the caller knows where the return value is, right? So relative to the current value of the top of the stack in the caller, therefore may use the value. Okay, so this is the reason that return happens. Okay, so the return sequence to restores the machine state to allow execution of the calling procedure to continue. Okay, so here you can see how it is, it happens. So ML is a functional language. I don't think it is machine learning. Okay. So variables are defined and have their unchangeable values initialized by a statement of the form like val name expression. Okay, then functions are defined using syntax like function name, arguments, and body. So for function bodies, we shall use let statement of the form, say let, so this is about ML language. So as we are not going to practice it, I think there is no need to give our head into it. Okay, then simple calling sequence. If you see, caller evaluates the actual parameter and places them into the activation record of the callee. Then caller stores a return address and old value of stacked off in the callee's activation record. Then caller increment the top of the stack to the beginning of the temporaries and local of the callee. Then caller branches to the code for all callee. Then callee saves all needed register values and status. Then callee initializes its local and begins execution. So this is the general thing happens. So in function call are going to happens. Okay, happen. So we understand this also, right? Then sample return sequence. If you see, the callee places the return value at the correct location in the activation record so that the caller can, you know, find it. Then caller uses status information previously saved to the to restore that stack stop and the other registers. Then caller branches the return address previously requested by the caller. Then optional thing happens that caller copies the return value into its own activation record and uses it to evaluate an expression. Then variable length data, what happens with them? In some languages, array size can be depend on the value passed to the procedure as a parameter, right? So like in Python, MATLAB, the array types, the data type, the array are not given. So whatever data we will provide based on that data type will be assigned to those array type variables. Okay, so in this case, all this thing happens. So this and any other variable size data can still be allocated on the stack, but below the caller's activation record. So in the activation record itself, we simply store pointers to the to be allocated data. So like this, you can see here, all these array data put it here, the parameter and return value, right? Then dangling pointers we are familiar with previously, right? And the stack dynamic allocation means that the pointers might end up dangling. Every novice C programmer makes this mistake at least once. Since when, as I told you, during our C programming, we have